Great. Thank you. Welcome, everyone. My name is Deborah Robin. I'm the executive director of JDI, use she, her pronouns. Hope you are nestled into a soft, warm place on this cozy, snowy day in many places. We are really excited about this week, today, this program. I want to just thank Nani for doing such an amazing job putting this together for our Winter Film Fest, as I keep calling it. We, as many of you know, we have been doing work around reimagining manhood for many, many years. And for the past few years or more, we have been offering a symposium as a way to lift up the issues related to gender and identity. And this year we are focusing on trans survivors and really talking about how that intersects with the work that JDI does as a state coalition against sexual assault and domestic violence. I know that we have people here from all over the country, and we're really excited to share this morning with you. So without further ado, welcome, thank you. And I'll hand it off to Nani.
Hi, everyone. My name is Nani Sajid. I use they and she pronouns, and I'm the Director of Prevention and Education at Jane Doe, Inc., the Massachusetts Coalition Against Sexual Assault and Domestic Violence. Welcome to Reimagine Manhood Symposium 2024, Transvivorship, Healing, and Joy. On the registration page for this event, I included a quote by Ocean Vuong, a Vietnamese-American writer from Connecticut. I'm from Connecticut, not from Chicago. This quote has made several rounds across the internet, so you may have already seen it. But it goes, "Being queer saved my life. Often we see queerness as deprivation, but when I look at my life, I saw that queerness demanded an alternative innovation from me, that I had to make alternative routes. It made me curious. It made me ask, is this enough for me?" And for me, as the director of prevention, I am often saying that prevention is world building work. And I believe that all of us are doing prevention regardless of what our titles may be. It is believing that a world without sexual and domestic violence is possible, a world without oppression, colonization, war, poverty, and white supremacy can exist. It is also recognizing that that world does not exist right now. It is all of us collectively saying no to Ocean's question that this is not enough, and still planting seeds towards that better world. I am humbled and grounded by the ways that trans communities and survivors constantly create microcosms of the world that we want through networks of care. Despite the fact that trans folks are facing the brunt of so many intersecting forms of violence, whether that's sexual and domestic violence or the violence of housing instability, job insecurity, poverty, hateful legislation, and so on and so forth, I see how trans folks reach for each other to create safer worlds, to say, you deserve more, we deserve more, and that we do this together. I see that in the work of Ms. Major throughout her lifetime and from all the folks that we will hear from this week. Oftentimes in our work in the sexual and domestic violence field, we say that we are centering trans people, but I don't know if we always are. And of course, my we here is very amorphous, it's not exact. If all we say when we say we are centering trans people is the death rates of Black trans women, then I think that we are actually taking part in the dehumanization in their dehumanization by reducing them only to the violence they experience. If the work we do when we say we center trans people is focused only on using the correct pronouns, then I do not believe that we are doing the work. If we're not sharing in trans people's joys, their accomplishments, art, sorrow, healing, and all the messiness that is life, then we are literally not part of their lives. Instead, I think that we do ourselves a disservice if we continue to relegate trans communities as solely victims instead of communities with a long legacy of carving out safer worlds for each other, and by extension, each of us every day. So I hope you use the next 3 days to be as present as you can be, to be a little bit kinder to yourself, and to lean into discomfort, see the ways that we might be flattening our movement and our work, and see the ways that our worlds can be expanded. And that's my little monologue for today. I'm gonna just switch over to mapping out what the next 3 days will be, and then I'll switch it to JR and Ms. Major. So just give me a second while I get my slides up. Okay. Let's see that. Okay, It seems like yes. Cool. Reimagine Manhood. So day one, of course, we're doing our interview conversation with Ms. Major and J.R. Mahung. This will be recorded, obviously, and we'll be here till 12. There will be time for Q&A. Tomorrow, we'll start with a screening from A Call to Men of their movie Intentionally Erased. And that will be about an hour. And we'll have some remarks from Bailey Buckles and Kim Yamatli from the A Call to Men team. They'll talk a little bit about how they made the movie and like just the background of it. And there will also be time for Q&A there. Right after the movie at 1, we will have a workshop with Lily Orion called Fighting Trans Misogynoir. And this will be a small space, so it's limited to 30 people. And it will be kind of a debriefing space for the movie, but also more in a mobilizing kind of space. And then our last day will be with Mira Memoirs. And we'll start with a screening of their movie, of their theater piece called Transmutation, a Ceremony. And there will be a workshop as well. And that'll be from 11 to 2. There'll be a 15-minute break in between. And then from 2 to 3, we will have a healing circle with Mira Memoirs, but it will be for trans, queer, and gender nonconforming survivors. So if you're interested in being the space, please email me. My email is on the screen. I will also type into the chat in a minute. And let me know, and I can register you and make sure you have the link. And so that's our schedule for the week. We're starting with Ms. Major and J.R. Mahung. I'm really excited for this. Start with J.R. J.R. uses she and they pronouns. And is a Garifuna poet from the South Side of Chicago. She has received grants and fellowships from the Academy of American Poets, the Massachusetts Cultural Council, and the University of Massachusetts Amherst, where they received their MFA in creative writing. She and her cat, Frank Ocean, who you might be lucky to see, also pictured very beautifully in this photo, are now based in Boston, where JR has served on the organizing team for the Louder Than a Bomb Massachusetts Youth Poetry Slam Festival, co-organized the Plantain Collection, a poetry reading and conversation series for writers of diaspora, and co-coached the Northeastern University Poetry Slam team. JR has facilitated creative writing workshops and classes for Amherst College Creative Writing Department, City Year Boston, Andover Breadloaf, and the Crisis Text Line. She was the 2017 Individual World Poetry Slam representative for the Boston Poetry Slam. Her poetry is published or forthcoming in Moko Literary Magazine, WusGood, Winter Tangerine, Freezeray Literary Journal, When Language Broke Open, and an anthology of queer and trans Black writers of Latin American descent, and elsewhere. JR's second chapbook, Since When He Had Wings, is available through Pizza Pie Press. And of course, Ms. Major. Ms. Major is a Black transgender activist who has fought for over 50 years for a transgender nonconforming community. Major is a veteran of the infamous Stonewall Riots, a former sex worker and a transgender elder and activist who has survived the Bellevue Psychiatric Hospital, New York's jail system, and the HIV/AIDS crisis. She's the co-author of the upcoming book, Ms. Major Speaks, which is alive and well. It's not upcoming, actually. And the subject of the 2015 documentary, Major. And the founder of House of Gigi, TILIFI in Arkansas, where she works to uplift transgender women of color, particularly those who have survived incarceration and police brutality. Okay, I am done talking. Thank you so much. Y'all can take it away.
Boo.
Hey, good morning.
Yeah. Good morning.
I know I asked earlier, but yeah, wanted to ask again, how are you doing? If you wanted to say in more of a full way this morning.
Fabulously today. Mm. Yeah. Even with the snow on the ground, I'm cool.
Okay. I love it.
Yeah.
I'm trying to get there too. Thank you, Nani, for the introductions, and to Jane Doe Inc. for having us. And yeah, I'm really excited to talk with you this morning, Ms. Major. I don't think I've shared this with you, but when I got the email from Jane Doe Inc. about having this conversation with you. I actually ignored the email for a couple of days because I was like, there's no way this is like an actual request of me. Like this is fake. And like, you know, this is a really elaborate scam. I don't know why people are trying to steal my money. I don't have much, right? Like, I'm like, they're here for my CVS coupons, I guess. As I got to speak with Nani and was assured that it is indeed real. And then, of course, when we had our initial meeting, the excitement just grew. And so I just wanted to name like my gratitude to you for kind of being here and being willing to speak with me. And also wanted to name that part of my excitement about and even disbelief at times about getting to sit down and speak with you was being a trans girl from Chicago and having the opportunity to sit down with another trans girl from Chicago who has like just made it further along in life, right? I think with trans people, and I'm realizing this with the younger trans folks in my life, there's often this desire to try and find some kind of model, some kind of like example of like, who do I want to be in the future? Because it's hard to see that in for a lot of folks, for a lot of people, you know, in their families, in their communities, wherever. I'm wondering, one, kind of, what does it mean to you to be, you know, your bio refers to you as a trans elder. I don't know if that's how you like refer to yourself, but I'm wondering, what does it mean to you to be kind of referred to as an elder? And also wondering, what was it like for you being younger, kind of trying to find those elders or those mirrors for yourself moving through the world?
Well, you know, when I was younger, there weren't any elders to look up to. Mm-hmm. And I felt as if then, you know, it was on me to make sure that I was okay. Nobody else could do that. And as time progressed, I got to see that there weren't any elders that I could rely on and trust and believe in. You know, when I was in Chicago, I met a woman named Kitty who turned me on to the style and way that I dress. And that has stuck with me all these years since then, because she gave me a sense of who I was. When I was going out for, they would put me in low heel shoes and dresses below the knee and all that shit. And she told me I was already tall, so fuck it, go for it, you know. And she put me a short skirt and 3-inch heels and blonde hair. And honey, I've been going ever since. as far as doing this stage where they're calling me icon, I don't feel like that personally, because I don't think that the thing that I've done to be an icon hasn't happened yet. You know, things that I've done in the past, that was just survival, you know. But, you know, if they do decide to do that or call me mother and stuff, you know, I graciously accept it and I go on, you know. Because if somebody takes the time to think about it and want to call me mother or something like that and make me a part of their family, who am I to tell them no, you know? So I graciously accept it. And it's got me here, you know. I'm 80 and counting.
I will likely have moments where I pause and just, soak in kind of what you say. I think what hits me, I guess for context for folks kind of watching, we had a sort of initial meeting about a week or so ago, and just to like introduce ourselves. And I think what struck me then, but then also now, is how much of the way that you speak is so like present in your book. And Miss Major Speaks, very aptly titled. and how, based off of kind of what Toshio Meren says in the introduction, was very intentional on your part, it sounded like. I'm wondering, what made it so important to really like capture your voice kind of in this book for you? Because I think there are a lot of ways of kind of going about a book and a memoir, and conversation seemed like a very purposeful choice. What led you all there?
Well, the whole 10 years that he was taking notes and stuff and remembering what I said, that was on him. And I remember we talked about it once a long time ago. And I told him that I'm okay if it sounds like me talking. If it doesn't, I ain't doing it. You know, because so many people want to take over your voice and who you are and what you stand for. And I've been fighting that since I've been born, you know? So that's out. No, I'm not going to have it. And so then he left and he started to write this book. And the book is perfect. You know, it's my words, what I said, when I said them. So that counts.
Yeah, what you just said reminds me of something in the book when referring to there was a filmmaker who was trying to make a film, it sounded like about I think about pride or something like that. And it sounded like her questions were really trying to lead you to the specific direction of the specific progress narrative of like, this happened and now everything's great, right? And there's a moment in that part of the book where you say, I knew there was gonna be a lot of me left on the cutting room floor. It feels to me, just from like my knowledge of your work and from kind of getting to hear it in your own words in your book, a lot of your kind of activism has been, fighting that sort of erasure, fighting that sort of what folks might call like an editor's touch, right? But ultimately is removing us from like understandings of histories, understandings of the present, understandings of the future. I am wondering if you could speak a bit about how did you first get your like start or movement into we call activism work? And I'm saying what we call activism work because I think off and on I hear you refer to it as, this is survival, right? This is what I needed to do. This is what, right?
Two things happened. First, a friend of mine by the name of Puppy died in New York in her apartment. She was drowned in her tub, and she had two Rottweiler dogs that she had raised as puppies. And whoever it was that killed her had to know the dogs very well. because he killed her and walked out of that apartment and left them sitting in the bathroom with her. You know, they had to know her very well. And then years later, I met Big Black, and he did the ride at having at Attica. And he brought me, well, he made me aware of the fact that if I want to help the community, there's other ways to go about doing that, that was the way I was going. And since then, I haven't looked back, you know. He has just left his plane, but he's very much in my heart and soul, you know.
I can very much like see it when you talk about Big Black, and also felt it in the book and other places where I've seen and heard you talk about him. And your descriptions about Big Black are really moving to me. Wondering if you could share a bit about how you all met initially and what it looked like, kind of that process of you sort of having conversations and being politicized in those conversations.
Well, I met him in the hole up in Dannemora, which is the prison system in New York City. And he came from Attica, and they had taken over Attica violently, just violently. But he came to the hole and they put him, I was already in the hole, we'll say. and so he was in a cell next to mine. Mm. And we struck up a conversation, and it was pretty pitiful because they put cigarettes out on him, cigars, kicked him, you know, just brutalized him, you know. And we talked about that, you know, and he explained to me that that was just the way that they did it in New York then. And so we spent about 2 months in there, and every day we would talk a little more. And about, oh, the third, fourth time or something, we bonded. There was a sense of I could trust him and he could trust me, you know. And so that grew, and it developed into a very bonding type friendship. He even wrote some poems and stuff dedicated to me and other people that he was with. And I left the prison with them, and then they destroyed them when we got outside. But that was very touching to me that he would feel safe enough to share with me these intimate things that he did to redact, you know. And that kind of lit a fire underneath me and made me want to make sure that whatever I did, you know, I knew he would approve of it and it was the thing to do.
I feel myself like approaching tears, which is kind of where I am most days. Just
I know everyone.
I'm a baby girl.
Yeah.
But what I'm reminded of in hearing you talk about Big Black just now is some moment in your book where you were talking about Big Black and referred to him as my mentor, my love. And I'm reminded of the many organizers that I know and mm-hmm. the sort of relationships that I've been able to develop in my own organizing work, primarily arts organizing, I will say, and the intensity of those relationships, and the kinds of trust and love and care that are possible in those relationships because of the intensity, because of the right. And part of the intensity is like, we are in this situation that is difficult or impossible to describe or share with anyone else. And part of our work is to, sorry, there's a noise outside. Part of our work is to change our conditions. And part of our work is to bring others into this like space that we're building and creating to allow us to change our conditions. And it's so amazing to me how it feels to me like a lot of your organizing activism, sort of safety building work for trans people stems from these interpersonal connections, the sort of love that you build with people. I'm wondering if you could speak a bit about, you know, when you are doing work with TILIFI, for example, when you are doing work with Angels of Care, for example, when you were doing work with, you know, wherever it was, how did you see your kind of like interpersonal relationships as a part of this larger sort of community work and vice versa?
Well, what it is that the fact that I always believe that there for the grace of God go I. And if you realize that, you're every person that exists, you know. And if it's something that isn't true or you think it's something wrong, that will come out on its own. You know, you don't have to push forward. And I believe that when I'm helping these people, whoever they are, whatever they are, you know, I am that also. You know, there's no difference in working the streets versus working at home. You know, it's still the same thing. You're still subjugated to somebody in charge of you, but you're still that person. You know, whether you're in the street, you're on the stroll, or whatever you're doing, you know. And when you go at it like I do, I feel as if, well, there's no harm that could come to me through that, because those people are fighting for survival. I am too, you know. There is no difference. And you have to accept that, you know. If somebody feels as if they're above the fray or whatever have you, well, then fine, you're above the fray. I don't have time because I'm struggling. They're struggling, you know. And so if I have a choice, I'm with them, y'all. Because if you don't struggle, you don't appreciate when you get it done, you know. So that's the way to go about it.
I love what you said, like anyone that I'm fighting with, I am that also, right? It's not the, I think I often hear the language of like allyship, right? The like, oh no, here's someone who's in trouble and so I have to go like help them. And you're already making a face. Yeah. It seemed like there were a few, you had a few things to say on that face, and I'm wondering if you want to share them already, because I think
no, I don't.
I should say I'm nosy and I'm messy. So
yeah, that's all right. You bit nosy, you like, I don't have to answer.
But I'm hearing in your like understanding, right? It's not this like, oh no, let me go help people. It's this if they can hurt this person like this, they can hurt me like this. And so they're hurting me like this, yeah. Right?
Yeah.
And that also reminds me of this mention of I think it was in the early 2010s, I want to say 2015, when you were receiving an award and spoke out against the sort of censorship or blockading of kind of Palestinian folks at the at this particular sort of award, and something that you mentioned in that in 2018 at the Creating Change conference. And something that you say in the book is like, it doesn't matter if someone's in Palestine or in Peru, like if they're one of my girls, they're one of my girls.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering how, right? Because I can see the like, okay, bad things are happening to the folks immediately around me. I need to do something about it. I can see the, okay, I'm organizing, like, you know, in this case, you were organizing with Big Black. There are like systems that are directly impacting the both of you and everyone else in the prison, right? Mm-hmm. And so this work, this effort to address what was in the prison, those conditions. And then there's that next layer of thinking globally. I'm wondering, like, how did you get to that point of being like, if something's happening in Peru, it's happening to me. If something's happening in Palestine, it's happening to me. I think just like making that connection is something that seems so massive to me, and also feels like an example of this massive capacity for care and recognition of not someone as another, but as someone who is struggling with you. I guess I'm wondering, like, how did you get to that place, right, where you see something happening in Palestine, for example, and you're like, okay, this is my struggle?
Well, first of all, I didn't really, when I started, I didn't see that the world is all one place, you know. It just happened because I was invited to, what was it, someplace overseas. I was invited to England and London, and I went there and spoke, and I got to talk to some of the girls who were there, who came to the event to be a part of it. And you can't help but feel connected to them because they're going through the same thing I'm going through over here. Mm-hmm. You know, it's not any different anywhere you go. The problems are still the same. You want jobs, you want a fair housing, you want to live safely. You know, all things that we can't get a hold of in the country that we're in. Let's not talk about overseas, Palestine or Peru, Egypt. You know, all of them suffer the same way I'm suffering here. And so when I do my work, I feel as if this is going to go around the world because the world is all just one place. That's all there is, one place. And we're all connected to each other. Every one of us, straight, gay, or whatever you want to call it, but we're all one. And so when something happens to one of us, it happens to all of us, whether you know it or not. And the thing is that you must do something to fight it. You've got to fight it, you know, because if you don't fight it, it means you accept it. You know, you want whatever's going on to happen to you, and you don't, you know. And so in the guise of me, I'm trying to fight for every one of us, everyone transgendered, everyone that is with us, because if it's better for us, then it's better for everybody else.
Thank you. Thank you. I'm just feeling a lot of gratitude in hearing your response. And something that this also brings to mind for me is kind of your own sort of path through, activist work, survival work, of like your work of various kinds, of different kinds. Mm-hmm. Because I think, like MLK Day was yesterday. I think when I hear folks talk about, you know, fighting for justice, doing like work of justice related work, it is often a very specific, like, let's go into the streets, let's march, let's practice specifically. I mean, and depending on who you're talking to, especially when we start talking about MLK, it gets messy because, like, some folks are like, civil disobedience is the only way to do it, right? And it's like, I don't know if that's how that works, right? Like, you know, am I trying to get beat up to get free? Like, is that, is that the plan? That's our plan. And I love how many different like examples or possibilities there are, even just in looking through your sort of the different kinds of work and the different roles that you have had. I'm wondering if you could just talk a bit about what has your work looked like over the years, you know, in whatever depth feels good for you.
Well, you know, for me, it's more a sense of whatever is happening at the time, it's happening to me. And so everybody else is also included in that. So I just bounce from one side to the other, back and forth, up and down, you know, to make sure that I'm all right. Because if I'm not okay, they're not okay. Mm-hmm. You know, and it's important that my community feels that I'm trying to get things right for us, not anybody else, just us. Because straight people have enough going on. Gay people have enough happening. Lesbians have enough going on. Nobody's caring for us but us. Mm-hmm. So I've got to make sure that they know I'm caring for them only. Mm-hmm. You know, I don't have time to pass some gay guy on the back and, oh, poor baby. No, I don't have time for that. You got a problem, go somewhere they can help you, because I can't help you. I help them, you know. Mm-hmm. And hobbying back and forth, different things come up, you know, like the AIDS crisis. Then the pandemic hits, and then this happens, and that happens. You know, and girls are dying left and right. No one is saying anything about it but us, you know. And it shouldn't be. We are just a resilient bunch of cookies. all of us, every one of us, male and female, we're a tough bunch to compete and we're not going to take this shit anymore. Mm-hmm. And that's the way we have to look at it. Mm-hmm. And fight? Oh yeah, we will fight, no doubt about it. Mm-hmm. Fuck that shit, kick that shit off, set it aside, and go forward.
I appreciate you. I think I'm also thinking about like the many different ways that like a fight can look. Because in some cases, you know, in your book you talk about like physically fighting, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like in other cases, you know, I think about Angels of Care, mm-hmm. which was a kind of, it's organized a group of trans mm-hmm. people to care for, it sounds like mostly like cisgender gay men.
Yes. Who were, mm-hmm.
Like, yeah. So like really dying from complications of HIV AIDS, right?
We took them on when they got to the state of where no one could be around them, mm-hmm. you know, when their sores were obvious and the mm-hmm. things on their skin were obvious. But I knew, and most of the girls knew, that you couldn't get this from rubbing them, you know. So we would rub them and take them, hold them close to us, you know, mm-hmm. so that they wouldn't feel alone. They would still feel like the person they were when they were younger, young and vital and caring people, you know. And that worked, you know, because so many parents and people who love them would pull away when it got to that, you know. And when it came to the last 10 stages of life for them, they would go down, you could count the way they would go down, you know. And it was hurtful, but it gave you a sense of joy because I felt as if they each left a part of them with me, mm. you know, to be strong and see this through to the next person and the next person and so on and so forth.
Mm. Mm. I really appreciate right, this like deep, meaningful, like literal care work for these men. Being, you know, like in the same trajectory of working for fighting for justice as, mm-hmm. You know, your earlier work organizing with sex workers to mm-hmm. ensure like safety, or to like, figure out how to keep each other as safe as possible.
Mm-hmm. Sure.
And, you know, like your other work, driving a van to, was it like picking up needles or dropping off sanitized needles
mm-hmm.
In California, your work with TILIFI now, your organization telling it like it fucking is, that seems to be focused on building a safe sort of space for trans people in Little Rock, Arkansas, where you're based currently. Mm-hmm. And all of these things being a part of the same trajectory towards justice, but also like can be seen as very different kinds of work. I just have a really big appreciation for that.
Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, thank you. I'm just here, like, this is cool. You did it. You're doing the work. I don't know what you're thinking before.
Well, we had to get you to come out here. And then you'll see for yourself. Because when you come out here, the thing that happens is you get a chance to relax, just let go. Think about why you started this thing in the first place. What keeps you going, you know? And then you expound on that. You relish it. You think it through. And then when you go back home, you go back and give those motherfuckers absolute total hell for fucking up in the first place. That's what it's for. And you gotta admit, you do need it. Lord knows we need a place to relax. Yeah. Yeah, you do.
Yeah. I'm trying to figure out how to ask this question in a way that doesn't feel silly, but
this ask is
okay. I will stop trying to figure out. Which is I guess I would love to just hear you speak more on the importance of like being able to relax and being able to feel safe, specifically.
Well, you know, first of all, you have to be taught to relax. You're taught everything else but how to relax. You go on vacation, and what do? I gotta go here, I gotta go there, I gotta go here. You don't have to go anywhere. You don't have to do none of that shit. All that stuff is set up so that you don't relax. You don't sit down and clear your mind and just think about what you're doing. Think about where you're going, what's going on, what's happening, why this happened, why did that happen. You don't have never no time to do that except when you're running here, you're running there, and you're not taking the time to just relax. When you come here, you simply, no doubt about it, you've got to relax, because you don't think about going out there. You don't think about going over there. You just hear and relax, period. And when you do relax, if you want, you come in here and you can talk with me. We can talk about anything you want to talk about. The moon rising, the sun don't come up, anything you want, you know. But just relax, you know. Don't worry about the cups and the saucers. Everything here is taken care of, everything. You don't have to do a damn thing except come into the airport and then whisk your way over here. And it's taken care of. Because my community is family. We're all related, every one of us. And we're related to each other. You know? What more can you do? No more than that.
Feels very connected to something that you say in your book, which is that for a lot of trans people, when they come out of the closet, they burn the whole house down. And so there's no closet to return to.
None.
Which also makes me think about section where you were managing, I believe it was Gigi's place, which was sort of, and this was Gigi's place, I want to say, in California, a sort of like transgender support wing for an AIDS like activism organization.
Yes.
And one of the earliest things that you did managing Gigi's place was bring in couches to give it a homey feel. and then mirrors so that girls could like get their makeup on.
Yeah. Can't see something. Especially if you look good to go out. You know, gotta make sure you have seen me in place.
It just, I got really emotional reading that because I remember looking in the mirror the first time I put on a dress, like really looking at a mirror and just looking at myself and being like, I can see myself finally, right? Like, here's this self that I've been avoiding for so long, and I finally can get a glimpse of her. And just even the small act of a couple couches and some mirrors, just even allowing space for one person to maybe get a glimpse of herself in that space, seems like something that right, like if you haven't had that experience, you may not know that that's part of, right, like what safety is and means. So I guess I'm wondering, you know, with TILIFI, with Gigi's Place, with the work that you've done in your life, what does it mean for you to be a trans woman caring for other trans girls and trans women and just trans folks broadly? Like, what does it mean for you to create that safety? And how do you see the importance of, right, like us creating safety for each other?
Well, when I see it, it makes me want to cry. I mean, I feel so good when a girl looks at that and sees herself. You know, if she's going out somewhere and she stops by Gigi's Place, just checking me, see me, whatever, and she stops and looks in the mirror, nothing can take that away from you. Nothing. Because no matter what you hear, what you see of other people, and nothing compares to what you tell yourself you look like. And honey, you look like $1 million and go out and give them hell, honey. Just go out and give them absolute total hell. And you know, it's a wonder that you can do these things. You know, what I think about when I set them up is, what would I have done? What would I like in saying that, you know? And when I do it, the girls respond. Nothing can take that away from me or them, you know? I always think about that, you know? And when I see them today, young, old, you know, I can see my imprint on them, you know? And that makes me feel good. You know, I smile inside and I'm overjoyed for them because, you know, if I got it, they can get it.
Oh, goodness. Oh. That's me. But you mentioned your imprint. And it makes me think about Cayenne Dora Show.
My baby.
Who's Big Black's daughter, if I'm not mistaken. And one of the connections that I just adored in your book was this moment where mentioned in a conversation with Cayenne for a show, she mentioned, you all meet, and she's like, you're Miss Major, and says that her father told her about you, and that he knew that she was trans and told her, let her know, like, this is who you are, this is what you are, and told her about you, to kind of, right, to say like, this is how I know, and this is how, right, this is how you know that you're not alone in this, right?
Mm-hmm.
And it kind of goes back to me to the beautiful relationship that you describe with Big Black, and how it's so charged with love and care. It's so charged with love and care, and the care seemingly sort of extends even to his daughter, to Cayenne.
Mm-hmm.
From what I can tell, is returned back to you in some ways from her also. I had a question somewhere in there. and then I just started feelings, and I was like, oh, right. So I guess I'm wondering, really, when you talk about leaving an imprint on people, that to me feels like perhaps one example. But I'm wondering, like, one, what would you like your imprint on people to be, kind of coming away from TILIFI? And it also makes me wonder, what are some of the imprints that you have had left on you, Crossed, if you are okay to share?
Well, as far as what my imprint would be, I don't know if I have a particular wish for something, you know, mm-hmm. whatever it is. Like, you know, some girls may come here and see that I collect turtles or I collect owls or whatever, and they get a turtle or owl, you know. That's it. You know, I don't expect nothing. I'm just glad that they stand in their own set of rules and live by them, devote themselves to them, make sure that nothing quakes them in that position, you know, that they don't have to bend, cower, or anything else to anybody on this earth, because they're a whole person by themselves. They don't need a man to make them a woman, or a woman to come and tell them, oh, it's okay if you want. You know what you are. You stand in your own belief and you be there, whatever you are. So, you know, it becomes a thing of, you know, you got to take the bull by the horns and bend the motherfuckers out and stand in your own light. You know, that's what I want. And that could be any number of things, you know, from looking in the mirror to standing up and tell somebody, no, I'm not gonna, and don't do it. You know, that's what I want.
When we first talked, something that came up was your ability to say no.
Yeah, you got.
I would love it if you could say more about saying no.
Well, you know, even if you have to sit at home and tell yourself, no, say no to the mirror, say no out loud, say no, I'm not going to, and then don't do it. Because a lot of times you say no, and they, oh, come on, please, I'll do it. Oh, okay, I'll do it. No, don't do it. Because when you do, you're going to get yourself. You don't want to do this thing. So don't do that, you know. There are things that, you know, parents do for kids. Well, wait a minute, who's running this family? The little kid of two-week-old or you? You're writing it. Tell that motherfucker no and mean it. Look, I've been in those situations and I wound up saying, yeah, okay. And I regret it every time. So now I say no, and that's it. You don't have to do it. And no is a very powerful word. Yes. No. Oh, it shakes them out, child. Makes them think, oh no, I can't do it. Yeah, well.
And it's, I love the like instances in your book of like, no, right? And it reminded me of some of my own, like my grandma, I love her very much. She loves me very much. And when we talk, she has this tendency to let me know like, hey, you know, do you go outside in dresses or do you wear pants? Because I would like it if you wore pants. And sometimes I don't have to be like, grandma, no, you know? And that's a version of no, right?
Yeah.
And there are other versions of no, right? And it's a version of no that still preserves myself in a lot of ways. And you talk about those sorts of no's, right? The no's that allow you to maintain sort of like, this is who I am. This is how I exist in the world. Mm-hmm. And also how those no's can allow you to, in the case of Talifi, for example, if I'm not mistaken, you mentioned when you first were getting started, people saying, okay, well, you should do support specifically around HIV and AIDS. You should you should make this an organization that's for the whole, you know, TL.
The T should come first, motherfuckers. But that's another story. Oh, God.
But, in each of those things, you told people no.
Yeah, hard no. No.
And it allows the space to be what it is, right? This place of safety, of care. That's something that just I appreciate kind of seeing in you and in your work. Mm-hmm. You've mentioned family, right? Like wanting the space that you build to create to feel like family, and also being open to when folks call you mother or what have you, to say, who am I to like say I'm not a part of your family?
Yeah.
And also community, and have talked about your own community. And it makes me think about like when people talk about the queer community, right? There's this large sort of umbrella, like anyone, you know, who's ever even thought about being gay once, like we're all, you know, we're all best friends, is like, I think how people talk about, like, right, right, is like how people talk about the community. And that's often not the case.
No.
And so I would love it if you could share, when you use the words community, family, what do you mean? Who and what are you referring to? And
transgender people, whether they're in it or not. Because you can be a transgender person and it doesn't show physically when someone looks at you. That's because you are you. What's inside you is another thing. They don't have to see a damn thing about it at all. And only transgender people, whether they're questioning or not, they are who they are firm in that belief, and it needs to stay there.
Yeah.
Because if I don't believe in them and see them for who they are, who is they going to be to do that? Mm. Who's going to acknowledge them for standing up and being themselves? Mm. Nobody. The gays aren't going to do it, the lesbians aren't going to, and cis people are not going to do it. Now, you may have a few people that will do that if they see that it doesn't affect them. They'll come and join your group or whatever. Mm-hmm. But technically, you have to leave them outside because they're not family, no matter what they do. They ain't family.
You said y'all could be neighbors, but not in this house.
No.
And something that I that means a lot to me in that is just the ability to maintain this care and willingness and desire for everyone to be free, while also maintaining priorities for yourself around, like, who do I want to prioritize in getting there? Right? And not like, I don't ever hear you speak and feel like there's the suggestion that trans people should have rights and no one else, right? It's not that sort of deal. It's a much more of a, like, everyone needs freedom.
Everywhere.
While we're getting there, I'm going to be with the trans people, right?
Yes.
To help us all get there, because we need that.
Yes.
And I love this ability to focus, to maintain and hone your focus, sometimes by saying no, while also keeping your eye on, you know, if the community, if the family is all living within one house, also, like, you know, poking your head out the window and saying hey to the neighbors every now and again, and making sure they have what they need too.
Yeah.
And that to me is it feels like a practice, something that has been practiced over time.
Well, you know, it has to be something to it because, you know, when you think about the fact that God or whatever made three people, Mongoloid, Caucasoid, and Negro. So there's three people, and all those people have turned into billions of people on this earth. Well, then why on earth can't we get along? Why can't one person say, well, I'm transgendered, how do you do? No, we can't do it because they want to beat the transgender person into the ground. Well, that's not going to work. Since they're at the bottom of the totem pole, take them out of that bottom and put them on top. And then all the good will flow down that totem pole. And then everybody will be free. But they got to see it first, and they can't see it. That's where the soul comes in. You know? Getting them to open their eyes and see it.
I know we're running kind of low on time, I wonder. So maybe is one of our last questions, something that's just been sitting on the surface for me recently, in our conversation at this point is with TILIFI, there's this sense of safety. And one of the things that you named was the importance of folks being able to, I'm sorry about the balloons. My camera does this thing where if I make a peace sign, it does balloons. And occasionally my hands will just do that. so that's a thing. I promise it's not me trying to add special effects. Sorry, I'm like, wow, what an interruption. But sorry. The question I'm trying to ask, because I guess I'm just thinking, at our initial like conversation, we shared about the first time we each wore dresses outside, and that being a really exciting and beautiful experience that felt very free and terrifying, right? And something I've been thinking about a lot is just like, right? Like, if I am free, then I have so much space for so many things. And that idea is terrifying to me. Because all of a sudden I have to invent a whole new existence. I have to invent a whole new life, you know? Mm-hmm. And so I'm wondering, in lieu of asking the like, what does it look like when we're all free and in flying cars, you know? I'd like to ask you, your work, the freedom, the justice-related work that you do, I imagine there's fear present at different points in time. What do you do with that fear? How do you move through the fear and move yourself towards the... right, that vision of freedom and that present, right, of freedom and safety and belonging, without sitting in that fear.
Well, what I do is I see it, I go through whatever changes I feel like going through, and then I go outside to the backyard and I breathe. And I look around at what I have and what I have for the community. And I breathe it in, I enjoy it. I wet my fingers in my toes in the grass. I feel the touch of nature on me. And then I come back inside and go on with my life, because you can't get rid of the fear in life. It's gonna come any way you is expected to. And I tell myself, you know, there but for the grace of God, go on, you know. And I settle in that. I enjoy or cry about that moment. And when I stop, I go outside and let it go, you know. And then I come back in there and I try to straighten it out so it doesn't happen again. And it keeps me going. I've been doing that since I've been 17. It's not easy, but it can be done. It can be done. I'm a living example of it.
Thank you so much.
Of course, you're welcome.
I also just like, so my family is Garifuna, or an indigenous people, an Afro-indigenous people to the Caribbean. And one of the things that I have felt in the past few years, just tried to like sort of remember my relationship to land. And the way I've been doing that is through gardening, often through planting manifolds, one of my favorite flowers, and lemongrass, which is a healing herb for us, and different herbs, and allowing myself to remember even in moments where, I feel very rejected in the world, right? If I'm going out and I get, called something or have a gross, awful experience, when the weather permits, being able to go out in my garden and remember that even if, right, like even if I don't feel valued by the people I was around that day, there's a way that the like earth remembers me. Mm-hmm. And, you know, allows me a place to stand and offers me air to breathe mm-hmm. and food to eat. And that being a way of allowing presence and something I'm hearing in your reply to like this fear is remember like, yeah, I'm scared and I'm also here. And and if I'm here, then I can do something.
Yes.
Yeah, so thank you. Thank you so much. I think I did ask that as if it was the last question. I realize I don't actually know where we're at on time.
We have another question. You can totally go for it. We're going to, just for so that folks know, we're going to take a little bit of a break so that people can, ritual things are weird and hard sometimes. So go stretch your body, do whatever, and then we'll do some Q&A. But Jared, if you have other questions, go for it.
I could. Yeah, I mean, I always have more questions. is it okay if I ask a nosy question and then more of a interview question? I just really like your mug and I'm curious where you got it from.
Who?
I just really like your mug and I'm curious where you got it from.
Oh, I got it at Walgreens.
Oh.
Isn't he lousy?
Yeah.
Max body.
Oh, nice and framed too.
This side says, good times. 10 lines.
Something I've just really enjoyed is you have fun.
Yeah, every day.
And I'm wondering, like, yeah, your sense of humor, your fun, your play. I'm wondering, do you see that as part of your work too? Is that like, you know, you're like, yeah, I do this work and I also have fun on the side? Is it like
that's it, nothing else but that.
Oh, okay. Makes me really happy.
Yeah.
I guess I do have one more question.
Sure.
Because you started out in Chicago, you were in California, you were in New York, and now you are in Little Rock, Arkansas. Now I think and we kind of talked about this a little bit the other day, right? Like there's this tendency for folks. I remember growing up in Chicago, there were times where people would be like the South and like as if anything that was south of Chicago was like, I don't know.
Yes.
Right? Like was like a plantation, right?
Yeah.
And it's like, I don't, that's not how that works. But it does make me, I would just love it if you could share a bit about, you know, like how you got to Little Rock and how you experience, you know, Little Rock and the South, probably.
Well, the South is no different than any other part of the United States. It says South. And when I came here, I came to see the movie show at a theater here. And I went outside to stand because I'd seen it. And I was standing there and I remember seeing the streets are so wide. And I thought, you know, my Cadillac would be great on these streets. I could hit this and turn here and, you know, I could do a thing with my car. So I moved here. Because why not? What the hell? You know, it ain't no different anywhere else. And when I got here, I was greeted by a bunch of young people who had heard about me. Mm-hmm. And they moved me into my house and stuff. I didn't invest in anything. I said, oh, this is nice. So I'm going to stay here. I ain't going nowhere. And then I bought this place. So fuck it. It's great. I don't want to live nowhere else but here.
Mm. Welcome to the snowy South.
My niche. Yeah. And now, and I have my car sitting out of the driveway, so 70 cab back. So
oh my goodness.
I'm ready to drive. This snow cold, I'm gone.
I love the idea of you just like cruising slow.
Yeah, there you go.
Yeah. Just gonna see. Yeah, just wanted to check again about time.
Yeah. So why don't we also, I am a notoriously bad driver, so I am happy for you in the Cadillac, but that is not my life. Happy for you. Why don't we take like a 10-minute break? Folks can do whatever they need to do to get back into their bodies and also ask some questions. We have a small list going. I also just want to offer something that Ms. Major has shared with us in our kind of like pre-conversation. That when we asked Ms. Major what she wanted everyone to walk away with, and she wanted to remind all of us that we don't have to change the world, which I think is hard for people who work in like the nonprofit social justice space. You know, we take ourselves very seriously. And you know, that's what we want to do. And sometimes that's like what our funders and our tasks are telling us to do. But instead you offered us a couple of questions that I just wanna let our audience sit with. What can you do to genuinely care about the survivors you work with, that you're doing this work for? How can you continue to give people something to believe in? So I'm going to leave folks with that. We'll come back at like 11:38. We'll do some questions and then we'll wrap up for this morning. Cool. Maybe I should play some music, but please go do your thing. And we'll be back at 11:38.
Be back real soon. Thank you again, Miss Major.
You're welcome, honey.
I'll see you in just a bit. Oh, is that Muriel there too?
Yes.
Hi.
Hello.
I thought
I've got
I heard
on my
your laugh.
Snow attire. I had to go through a snowstorm to get here this morning.
Oh my goodness. Oh my goodness. Happy you made it in safe. Oh.
Yes, yes.
All right, I'm gonna run off camera for just a bit, but okay. Really lovely see you in just a second.
All right, baby.
Okay, we're off camera for a minute.
Maybe time we've no control. If the sky is pink and white, if the ground is black and yellow, it's the same way you showed me. Nod my head, don't close my eyes, halfway on a slow move. It's the same way you showed me. If you could fly, then you'd feel south. Up north's getting cold soon. The way it is, we're on land, so I'm someone to hold true. Keep you cool when it's still alive, won't let you down when it's all ruined. Just the same way you showed me, showed me. You showed me love. Glory from above, regardless, dear. It's all downhill from here. In the wake of a hurricane, dark skin of a summer shade, nose diving the flood lines, tall tower, milk crate. It's the same way you showed me. Cannonball off the porch side, older kids trying off the roof. Just the same way you showed me, you were sure. If you could die and come back to life, up for air from the swimming pool, you'd kneel down to the dry land, kiss the earth that birthed you, gave you tools just to stay alive and make it up when the sun is ruined. That's the same way you showed me, showed.
Hi, everyone. Shout out to Nithya for playing some Frank Ocean, whether the cat or the man, the legend, either way, for us. Cool, that's good.
There you go.
Let's get started. Some questions. And some of these questions might be for Miss Major, but also Jer, if you want to jump in and add some, please do. Someone in the audience said the cat's got a beautiful voice. I believe it. I agree. Yes. Sorry, JR's cat is Frank Ocean, in case we're all giggling about something that no one else knows. Okay, first question. Could Miss Major talk about why the T in TLGBTQ should be first? They did say that they're very interested in that and can probably guess the answer, but would like to know your input.
Well, it's really simple. First of all, who started this thing to begin with? The transgender people. Who were the ones that got beat up the most? It's the transgender people. Not the gays, the lesbians, and all that other shit. It's the transgender people. Now, why they had this meeting and came with GLBT, I don't know. But T should be first. Yeah, thank don't you. Like that, then kiss my ass.
Thank you. We have a question from Hema. I'm going to ask if Hema is okay with speaking out loud. I think Nithya might be able to set that up for us.
Beth added her as a panelist. Okay, there they are.
Hi.
Hi.
It is such an honor to be here with you all. I'm so excited for this moment. Thank you so much, Ms. Major and JR, and of course, Nani, for putting this all together. I'm Hema Saring Siminski, and I use she and they pronouns, and I'm the deputy director here at JDI. And my question, I will actually read it because I feel like I wrote it. I'll just follow it along. but basically, my question was about any advice that you would have around intergenerational organizing around trans solidarity and trans liberation. You know, I am now, I guess, a middle-aged person, and in some spaces would consider ourselves at the beginning of queer elderhood in certain ways. And, you know, I have been trying to get friends of mine who are in academia and other things to try to do a
a re-upping of a queer studies for queer elders type of effort. I haven't gotten any takers yet, but I mean, that aside, I really would love to hear any thoughts that you have about working across generations in this movement, both and any advice you have to elders in this field as well as younger folks to really hear and share each other's collective wisdom, knowing that, you know, sometimes there are changes in our language and our perspectives and our organizing approaches. And this is really to either of you. I would love to hear your thoughts on intergenerational solidarity in trans liberation.
Well, the first thing they have to do is do something about these anti-trans laws. They're not anti nothing else but trans. And that's everybody. I started going around to different little groups and stuff throughout the South. And I'm telling these young people to get off their fucking ass and do something about this. Because this time, they're not playing. They're serious about this shit. They wanted to make us pay for what they're thinking, and that's not happening. They need to get up and do something. And as for the older people, you've got to convince them that they were young once themselves. I remember when I was 19 years old and kicking ass. Well, guess what? You still gotta kick ass. You gotta get up and do the shit. It doesn't matter what it takes, no matter what you gotta do for it, get up and do it, you know? And if you are trying to get them to work together, honey, you got a job on your hands, because it ain't easy getting old girls to work with the young girls, because the young girls don't care. They don't think about this thing like we do, you know? So find a way to get that to work and that'll happen. What you guys are saying?
Yeah, I mean, I think just to go off of that, so a lot of my work has been in schools, and working in high schools primarily, but also some universities, and also at times in my creative writing work, working with younger poets. And I think in those situations, a lot of the solidarities between myself and other trans, like younger trans people, and older trans people as well, like trans people older than myself, is in those immediate community spaces, right? When I was working at a high school and had trans students who were trying to figure out resources around chest binding, we had conversations about, okay, what does safety look like in this moment, right? Like, knowing that this could be, if done improperly, a really unsafe practice. What are, like, responsibilities for us as adults, myself and the other like staff that I was working with and teachers I was working with, having conversations with the nurses in the building and seeing, like medically, what do we need to be considering? The social workers, right? And I think in this case, it was about building networks that these young people could access, and knowing that they had those networks and ensuring that they always knew that I was a part of that network. And I think in when thinking about folks who I see as trans elders, for myself, feeling that they did a similar thing for me, right, is like creating networks and ensuring that I knew that I was always someone who could go to them as a part of my network. And I think for me, that's the first step, is just making sure that folks know, I don't necessarily know what you're going through or understand all the time, but kind of as Ms. Major was saying earlier, right, this thing that's happening to you is also happening to me, even if in a different way, and I'm here so that we can figure it out together. Yeah, and allowing that to be the first step and building from there. I know it also is tricky because, you know, in my case with job things, like whatever, you're trans at a place of work, you may not be trans in that place of work soon. You might, you know, you might be elsewhere without a paycheck or whatever, right? And so also like, yeah, I think there's, you know, that can be difficult when the stability isn't there though as well.
Thank you both so much. And I just want to echo like how beautiful this conversation was. I was so real. I feel like I was giggling half the time and just like, yes, just so happy to hear both of you. So I have a question, kind of, this is directed to Ms. Major. At the beginning, you kind of talked about being perceived as an icon and that you don't feel like you've done like the thing to be an icon yet because what you've done and all your work has been about survival. So is there something that you want to accomplish or see that you would consider iconic?
I don't see it yet, but it's out there, whatever it is, something. And when it happens, I'll see it. And then if I get there, I'll do something about it. Until then, who knows?
Thank you.
You're welcome, honey.
We have a question from Jennifer Williams. I can read it out loud if you'd like, but if so, Jennifer, if you want to go off mute, or actually I think Nithya might need to do that for you. But can you just let us know if you want to say your question out loud?
Hi there. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, fine.
First off, thank you so much for this wonderful conversation. I really appreciate all your insight. I work at a youth center for queer and trans youth. I am an older person as well, but I work directly with them, teaching them, advising them, et cetera. So something that I see a lot in our queer and trans youth where I am is a sense of fatality, a sense of like nothing they do matters because they're not gonna have a future anyway. So it creates a kind of apathy. JR, I can see this touching you. You know, it breaks my heart to see because what we do does matter. And so I'm wondering if you have any advice on how to instill a sense of hope in young people that feel like there is no hope and no future.
Well, you know, they've got to feel as if there's a reason for them to live and keep going. And you can remind them that if I had given up when I wanted to years ago, I wouldn't be here. And right now I'm 8 years old and fuck it. They can keep going and live to get to this age and look back on it and tell the young people again that they got to keep going. They can't give up now. They got their whole life ahead of them. They don't know what tomorrow is going to bring. Yes, they may be hungry. So they figure out a way to eat. If they don't have something, they figure out what to do to get it. There's always an answer. There's always a solution. They can find it. They must find it. And they will.
Thank you.
Oh, I think JR just rose. Okay, when JR comes back, we can have him speak. I have two questions because, and I'm gonna try to answer them quick or ask them quick, whatever, being selfish, sorry. I am the youngest in many ways in my family, chosen, biological, whatever. And something about being the youngest is always looking towards elders and asking, or like trying to note down people's mistakes and trying not to make those mistakes. And if you would like to share. Can you tell us a mistake that you've made and what you've learned from it? Whether that's organizing or whatever.
Mistake that I made? I don't know what mistakes I've made. I just keep on going. Whether I make a mistake or not, oh, well, that's happened. Keep on going. Don't concentrate on your mistakes. Those teach you a lesson. Hold on to the lesson. Let them go and keep on going. That's the only way you're going to make it. You can't pay attention to your mistakes. Shit. If that was the case, I wouldn't do nothing. I'd sit at home. Oh, Lord, no, can't do it. Yes, I can. And I do. You will.
Jared, did you want to answer the previous question? It seemed like you were going off mute for that.
I just wanted to second something Ms. Major said about, like, I think what I have seen with young people is once they, when it comes to making a difference, a big question I am always like considering is like, who are you making a difference for? And what does that mean and look like? And I feel like there are moments with students, with young people where like if I or someone around them is able to make a small difference for them, they feel more able to do the same thing for another. And I think starting there, right? Like, so kind of going back to the resources. And even sometimes it's just like, hey, here's a room, you can come in and be yourself, you know, as much as possible. Or, you know, and then hearing, oh, this is something you're struggling with. Are there things we can do about it? And kind of in going through that process, that day-to-day of building that relationship and allowing the problem solving to take place kind of organically, it begins to show that person like, oh, right, there are things that can be done about this. Even if we can't change it, there are ways that we can build like safety or support around it. And that being the start of, you know, making change or organizing.
We have two more questions. One of the things that Ms. Major, that you said in your book, you talk a lot about the phrase, like the powers that be. And sometimes it seems like you include nonprofit actors in that as well. And I'm wondering if you can speak to that a little bit. I think it might be hard for us to know.
Look at the number of people that do this work because, oh, if I put this on my resume, it'll make me look like I do it all the time. Yay, I'll do that. Fuck that shit. Use people that care about the people on the bottom that are struggling, doing without, trying to make it, trying to be okay. Those are the people you want to run this shit. These are the motherfuckers, oh, I'm doing it for my resume. I'm doing it because it looks good on paper. Fuck paper. Paper ain't got a goddamn thing to do with what you're trying to do. Do it because you care. If you don't care, then don't do it. And give me that shit. No, that's ridiculous.
Thank you. Jared, do you want to say something to that?
I mean, that's what it is. I guess the only thing I'll add is, I feel like in the nonprofit world, there's this tendency to focus on, in my experience, this tendency to focus on the like cosmetic things, right? The like trans visibility, use the right pronouns. And I've been in a lot of education institutions. And so there's this like, we're going to read trans writers. And like, that's cool. And like every trans person going through this space is like trying to get out as soon as possible because it's miserable, right? There are dress codes and things that don't account for the fact that like, trans people have to show up in a way that feels comfortable. And so someone with a particular body might be wearing a suit and like that needs to be okay.
Thank you. It should be.
Right.
When they take the time to understand this, I'm he, she, him, her, it, they, thus, thus, everything you name it, I'm one. So fuck that shit. Call me Mr. or it don't matter. Just call me. All you gotta do, Major, I'm here.
Right. And yeah, and folks seem to like really miss the mark on that, right? Is the like, the thing that's important is I call you the right pronoun, as opposed to like, oh, you need healthcare. You need to like, right? Like if you're having a dysphoria morning, you need to have space to like, right? That morning. And so you can come in a bit later, right? Like, you need support like with Ubers and Lyfts because where you're at is unsafe to take public transit. These are the things that like are important. And like, if I get called a man all day, but I have those other things, like, I don't know if the pronoun situation matters that much. But when I don't have those things, everything else is harder and is rough. And I think that's kind of, folks getting stuck on the, on the things that matter, but aren't the thing, right? Yeah.
Thank you. Last question, and we might run a couple minutes over, which is fine on my end. Let me get the actual question up. Both to Ms. Major and JR, what is something good? This is partially because someone is keeping a list of good things, so they just want to know all your like the small joyful things, whether it's the Walgreens mug or anything more bigger and expansive. Another person also asked a very similar question. What outside of the work brings your soul's joy?
Walking outside in the grass. I mean, nature is a wonderful, wonderful thing that we have that we don't take advantage of. You know, to walk out there with the snow on the ground, so you slip and fall. Big deal. You know, the soul's not going to kill you. So you fall. Oh, well, I fell. And go get up and do something else. You know, nature is it. No matter what you do, if you disregard on that, feel the in the summertime. Take your shoes off and wiggle your toes in the street there. You know, nothing beats that. Nothing at all. Smell a little flower. They're lovely, the flowers, you know? Do something that makes you feel grounded on this earth. Not somewhere in the sky, but grounded in the earth. What do you say?
I have a little niece and a little nephew. And actually two more little ones on the way from my older sisters. And I also have three much younger siblings. And I think just really like the young folks in my life, just seeing how they think about the world, how they process, how they, the stuff that they make. My little nephews laugh. Watching movies with my little niece when we get a chance to. All of those things. Yeah, I think the something I've really struggled in the past has been to imagine myself in a future, which I think Ms. Major is part of why it has been so meaningful to get to speak with you, right? Is this like, oh, here's a possibility, right? And I think with the younger people in my life, I am given more of a reason to want to imagine myself in a future. Is this like, you know, I don't know if I know who I'll be, but I know the role I want to play in this young person's life. And I think that feels like a way of imagining myself in a future, and that feels like something good.
Yeah, see, I have a 3-year-old son now, and it's like a new lease on life, you know. I feel like go for another 8 years. But the thing is that I get to see him laugh and enjoy things that are just normal stuff, you know? And it means a lot to me to realize that there is his life in front of me, you know? And I'm a part of it, you know? So you got to keep going. You must keep the faith. Mm-hmm. And eventually, sooner or later, we'll change it. You know, we all will pull together, we will change it.
Thank you.
Whether they live or die.
Thank you both. The past like 2 hours have been so giggly and sweet. And I have been seeing some comments on the side and talking with my coworker, and everything's just been really beautiful. Thank you. Thank you to folks in our audience who are just showing all the love. Thank you so much. I also like give a shout out to Nithya, who's been holding down the tech thing. It is hard for me to do, my brain splits when this happens. And also thank you so much to Nicole, Carrie, and Megan for doing all of our interpreting and cart captioning. Everyone, please read Miss Major Speaks. Also, please fill out that little Google form I just put in. Because it helps us know. Oh no, it's blurry. Sorry. Yeah, thank you so much. We'll see hopefully all of you tomorrow for the second day of our Reimagine Manhood series. I hope you all have a great day.
Good. And listen, you get in touch with me. You hear me?
Should.
Okay.